It's great to be here on time. So what we are going to show you now is how can we build up a kind of the most realistic supply picture on global shale. And then first we have to look closely at North America. Why has it been so successful in North America? What has been the drivers for that success? And then we are looking at those drivers and see, are they existing in the rest of the world? Of course, we first have to start to make an estimate of economic recoverable resources. There has been some estimates on technical recoverable resources, but it's a long way from technical recoverable unconventional resources to profitable production. And so then we are doing a quite detailed subsurface analysis of all the global international source rocks, shale formations. And then we are doing what I would call a surface analysis to figure out if the profitability potential is there. So then starting about why is it successful in North America? I will start to look at the geology and what happens when most of these successful American plays, they were created around the late Devonian, with many exceptions, of course. Utica was earlier, Monterey is Miocene, but many of these plays that we know was born at a time when America looked like this, where you have a very the Rocky Mountains in its early infancy, a back arc island bow created by the subduction of the Pacific Plate. And then you had a large protected inland ocean, which was in a tropical environment. A lot of organic life, very rich source rock, but equally important that it had this content of silica that is required for the shale to respond to hydraulic fracturing. Other shales that were born in this period is Marcellus. It was a little earlier than Bakken, but you can see from this this dark blue here corresponds to the core sweet spots of Bakken today. So in this this is the fairway that goes up in Duvernay and further up. There are many shales, stacked potentials up here in British Columbia. But you see very clearly that there is some darker blue here, which is a kind of deep hole in the ocean bottom where we had more anoxic conditions and also faster coverage with sediments. And the sediment source was the Appalachian Caledonian at that time. We might have had some kind of geophysic consistence that added to the frackability of the shales that were created at this time. Then we are looking at the next interesting period, which is the late Cretaceous, where you had a lot of calcite formations, and then you had Eagle Ford and you had Niobrara were formed at this time. And then we can look at what we see here. They know the Rocky Mountains is growing older. So now it's growing thick by some other geology event. I just saw a really nice video on YouTube actually on how the Rocky Mountains is shaped and it's lifted up by the subduction plate that rebounds and touches the crust and pushes up the Rocky Mountains. I'm not a geologist, but I like geology a lot, like many of you. So I try to understand it from a physical geologic point of view. Then we can look at similar areas around in the world. In the late Cretaceous, you see up here where you have Western Siberian, the Bashanov Formation. I don't remember right now if Bashanov Formation was created at this particular time, actually. And then you see that you have some kind of inland oceans where you get less circulation and more anoxic conditions. But also, I think it requires some circulation, and I think salt water provides more rich kerogen. So maybe lacustrine shale doesn't have to be as prospective as marine shales, where you have rich organic life, but you also anoxic conditions. And then we have done this very detailed for 20 plays in North America, where we have studied all the companies, all the acreages, all the empiric wells, and tried to understand what is actually driving the prospectivity in these plays. And this type of analysis is available in a report that we are selling together with Heart Energy. Then let us now look at how we are doing this. First, we are looking at the best available geologic information about every play, ESO curves on depth and thickness and thermal maturity. Then we are digitizing this information in our own system, and we are looking at how this corresponds with empiric well data to understand what is the weight factor of these various drivers, what is important for that particular play. Then we make what we call a evaluation map to show the sweet spots. And we got a question of how large are the sweet spots. And here you have one answer. How large is the darker brown as compared to the entire play? And for a barnet, if you include wetness in the definition of sweet spots, then you see that it's about a quarter of the entire play. Next step is to look at the well curves, and then we look at every single company's acreage. We put it on the top of the valuation map to figure out which companies is best exposed to the sweet spots. And here you see this nice purple large area here, which is exposed in Wise County, where we think it's good because it's some NGL and wet, that is Devon. And then you have, for instance, so that was nice. This is Devon. That is in the core of the wet gas area on Wise. And then you have up in the Combo area in Montague. You have you see EOG, of course, and you also have Pioneer that has some really nice acreage up here. And then we build up the well curves, very individual per location in every play. So these are the decline curve, and this is the cumulative production curve for each particular spot around. And then we use the empirical well curves. We use what the companies are saying, but we don't necessarily believe in everything they're saying. And we are looking at our own kind of bottom-up understanding of what drives it. And then we get, as an implication of this, we get a very high quality forecast for the liquids and gas potential coming from shale in North America. And our latest estimate, so this lower here is crude oil, that is condensate, and this is NGL. So on the liquid side, we think that it will be possible to produce 6 million barrels of liquids and 5 million barrels of oil by 2020 already. And this is one of the quickest growth of any kind of petroleum play in the world. It is only beaten by some years by Saudi Arabia when they were ramped up really in the 70s, but this is the quickest thing we've ever seen. But it's a lot of investment behind this production growth. On the gas side, we have seen that the rig count has gone down below the balancing point for the rig count. The balancing point of the rig count is about 550. So if the rig counts for a longer term goes lower than 550 in the US, then production will balance and slowly go down. Now, the number of actively drilling horizontal gas rigs in the US has been as low as 250. So now we have seen that production has started to stagnate at least, but some seasonality effects there. But the rig count actually the last couple of weeks has rebounded a little on the gas. And the prices has taken up. But there is no kind of high ceiling for the gas prices in North America because it's determined by the marginal cost of drilling and the break-even prices, which for Marcellus, you have large area that has break-even prices around $3. So the gas price, even if it's improving from a low of 2, it has a ceiling determined by the break-even prices of something around 4, in our opinion. Then we look at the contribution to the total supply picture in North America coming from shale and tight oil. And the red line are the demand curves. And we see that it's actually possible. And I think that our forecast is fairly realistic and not upside the type of optimistic forecast at all. But it seems that it's a potential to balance with the demand for total liquids around 2020 for North America, and I think this includes Mexico as well. And on the gas side, you see that there is a potential oversupply, but not a lot of potential, but that this all depends on which kind of gas prices and how much LNG export we believe in. But if this is right, then the LNG export is going to be fairly marginal. I think it was a figure that I didn't... I'm coming back to that. And then we are starting looking at the international. And first we look at all the known source rocks in the entire world. So So I think it's very interesting to just look at which source rock has already proven their petroleum potential because they have fed conventional oil and gas fields. And here these are the standard geologic colors, so we can see the kind of Atlantic Rift Basin started up in the Jurassic and down in Cretaceous, and then you see the Niger Delta Basin, which is more in the kind of Neocene, and you can see these delta basins. But here we have looked at every source rock and looked for all the characteristics that can tell us whether the North American conditions can be replicated around in the world. And we are then doing the same valuation maps as we have done for every play in North America, also for international plays. So this particular case is the Bacheno Formation, which is a source rock for the West Siberian plays, where ExxonMobil and Rosneft has a joint venture that they developed. So we have looked at these kind of characteristics. Again, the same depth, thickness, and also I looked a little at sedimentary thickness because you don't get all these kind of core samples available in Russia because they are not used to drill down to the source rock when they're drilling into conventional reservoirs. So you don't have so much information, but the sedimentary thickness is a very interesting parameter that they used in this case. But when you look at Bacheno, it seems like doesn't respond all this. It seems like the limiting factor is that the Bacheno formation is very thin. It has large areas, or more than 50% of the surface extent, has a lower thickness at 20 meter. And normally we consider that 100 feet is the kind of minimum thickness in order to get some kind of profitability out of the fracking, the large enough fracks. So that's the Bacheno Formation, and we've done this for other places around the world, at least where there are some industrial activity and people that are interested in paying for this kind of analysis. But a lot of places are so early, so there is no use to do this kind of more detailed analysis. Here I'm looking at a very detailed sedimentary thickness map that we put together with the source rock qualities. You know, sedimentary thickness, of course, is important not only to cook the petroleum, but also to have more probabilities of source horizons and reservoir horizons. So the thicker, the better, both for the maturity of the kerogen, but also for the probability occurrence of various petroleum plays. So this is available information that we have digitized a little on our own, and we compare it with the source rock around in the world. And then we are looking at something extremely important, is how good looking are these shale formations. You know, in North America, many of the shale formations, even though it's a lot of variations in North America also, Marcellus is a little folded, but many of these formations in North America, they are very neat, flat, and homogeneous. But around in the world, the situation is quite different because of tectonic activity. But if you look, for instance, at the Sichuan and Yangtze platform, you see that, yeah, there is a part of the kind of western Sichuan looks fairly good, but the Yangtze platform, where they have, and this is the area where they have licensing in China right now, the licensing round with 20 blocks, many of them is in this area with little potential. And here you also see things like this can be due to a kind of hot spot that has lifted up and then overcooking the gas in the Ordovician area, and that's why we have sour gas in the Sichuan. But what very interesting is that in this layer, in this thick Jurassic play in the western Sichuan, they have actually fracked and completed a gas well that produced 17 MMCF per day. So that is one of the best information I had on gas flow rates globally. But also, I think that some of the northern plays in China, they are lacustrine, and we don't have too much experience, as far as I know, from US on lacustrine shales. And the kerogen is not so fat and doesn't maybe provide with the same probability the correct talk. And then we are looking at activity, of course. In order to forecast production, we have to always follow how far has the activity come around in the world. So we are looking at flow rates, completion, stratigraphic wells, and licensing activities. This chart shows the flow rate or completion type of activity that you have seen around in the world. Here is this well that you talked about, a Sinopec well in the northwest Sichuan. Very interesting, of course, what's happening in Argentina. Also, Argentina has some of the similarities with North America geologically. And it's extremely thick shales, even though it's a partly a rift basin, and syn rift formations will be more chaotic and more fault, so maybe not as good as deep ocean formations. But the Neuquén Basin is a post-rift formation with Vaca Muerta. Los Molles is the deepest, and Vaca Muerta, and then Argio, I think. They are developed vertically, and vertical wells produce something around 200 and up to 500 barrels per day, which is fairly good for vertical wells. But I think I have more on that, maybe. A little about how we are estimating resources. We don't start with the volumetric resources and look at recoverable rate. We look at resource recovered resource density. How much has these wells in America actually produced per unit of surface area? And then we look at Marcellus, Barnett, Fayetteville, Haynesville, and look at how much have they actually been able to produce per section in America. It's of course a large spread of this. But we are looking at some kind of average figures, and the average among these four gas plays happen to be around 6 BCF per square miles per section. And then we look into one area like the Poland. We look at what are all these geologic characteristics that we talked about. So we risk it in two steps, technical, volumetric type of geology risking, and then more commercial risking, subsurface factors, but I also include has actually this particular source rock proven its petroleum potential as a source to conventional oil and gas fields? And in Poland, they haven't actually. The Silurian rocks in the Lublin Basin and Podlesie Basin and Baltic Basin has in very little degree been a source for oil, conventional discoveries. So there we get to, we got, this is actually 2 years old, this estimate, but we have kept it. We estimated 2 years ago at 1 TCM. At that time or later after this, EIA came with an estimate that much higher. Many other had 6, 7 TCM. We had 1 TCM. And now after the little disappointment and the majors has pulled out, ExxonMobil tried to frack in the Lublin Basin, but the well didn't respond to the pressure they applied. So they withdrawed, many people have taken it down, but we have stayed at this estimate since we did it 2 years ago. But maybe now we take it a little down. Just to tell that there is some credibility around the figures that I'm going to show you. Then we have done this for 260 shales in the world, 35 shales in China, and for every single country we have done looked at the source rocks that has been reported in the literature. And then we are comparing these shales by looking at some simple drivers, thickness, talc, thermal maturity, depth, acreage, and we are scoring them and comparing them with American shales. And you see that these nice shales in the Western Sichuan look good, Vaca Muerta looks good, Baltic Basin in Poland looks quite good. Surprising that Haynesville is so low, but it's because we haven't included the pressure gradient, which is very high in Haynesville. So it's not only the depth that is good, it's even more important that you have energy in the formation, and the pressure gradient in Haynesville is 0.9 psi per foot, and it doesn't happen to be a part of the criteria in this particular analysis. Then we will get to our resource estimates around the world. Brazil has a lot of really nice shales. Russia also, but they have so much conventional, so we don't really believe that will be the first kind of country with production. Argentina, China, Indonesia, Venezuela, and then around Caspian, there are some nice shales. Ukraine, of course, and we see also the gas split, gas NGL condensate split, which is mostly driven by the Kerogen type and the thermal maturity that we have found in our research. And these figures, 700 billion barrel of oil equivalents, is far below what, for instance, EIA has in their report. And we call these economically extractable shale resources, as difference to technical recoverable shale resources. And now we start to think about production time. What is the kind of development time scale? And we had some questions about that as well. Barnett shale play, the red are the vertical wells, and this yellow is the horizontal wells. It took 20 years to really understand what to do on Barnett. Barnett, they said that it cracks like a glass, but when they really figure out what kind of pressure and what kind of technologies you use on that play, it went quite fast. But thanks to the learning from Barnett on Fayetteville, it only took 5 years. But weather, when you come to a new region with very different geologic settings, I think that you are more likely to be more in these kind of context than in these context. Now we're looking a little more at Argentina, which is a really nice success story so far. There are very thick shales. These are coast drift formations, several kilometers thick, each of them. Agrio is maybe a little not really mature yet in the oil window, but you see that it has a large oil window, but probably not so much energy. Vaca Muerta has a nice oil window, not extremely thick, but the energy in Vaca Muerta is more in the gas condensate part here. And Los Moles is so deep, so it's mostly gas. And then we get to the conclusion, what is the kind of timeline of development of all these shale resources? Well, all our kind of surface type of analysis tells us that we don't think these will really kick off and start in commercial terms before 2020. But the potential globally is something like 25 million barrels of oil equivalents. But it's a long time to get to those levels. And then the split per gas and oil. So on the oil side, if you say that oil is crude oil and condensate, then you get to something like 5 to 7 million barrels by 2020. Nothing really significant. It cannot really kill oil prices, but it will probably stabilize oil prices because shale oil development is so flexible. You can switch on and off, so probably it will contribute to be a kind of global swing producer. Also thanks to the very widespread of break-even prices that you have on shale plays. So this will be, I think it will be a good news for everybody, and conventional and offshore and everything, that this shale potential will contribute to lower volatility on oil prices, which is a little curse for the oil industry because it kills investment during cycles. Yeah, and then of course we're also doing cost estimates, even if it might be a little speculative, but we are actually looking at the depth and we are looking at various parameters on geology to figure out how long time it will take to drill. So in general, we find that costs with global shale, taking into account these kind of not so nice looking formations, not so much manufacturing processes as we have seen in North America, the cost will be higher. So we think that the total cost for global shale will grow like this and reach a level of $150 billion by 2050. And that is actually where you are on North America shale development today. If you include the cost of transporting the oil and the gas, you are at the annual investment level today around $150 billion for tight oil and shale gas in North America, Canada included. So for global, I think I said for North America that already in 2020 the contribution would be, what did I say, 20 or 50% or something. But globally, the contribution will be only 10% for oil and 25% for global gas as far out in time as 2040. So my little conclusion after all these exercises is that, yes, there is a lot of resources. Yes, it's really incredible what has happened in North America. But we shouldn't be so sure that we will have the same kind of abundance of cheap shale, oil and gas in any part of the world other than North America. That's my kind of moderating statement, because there is so much other statements around. So I think it's that's the right statement to balance the attitude a little to the potential success outside North America. And of course, we are a data provider company. Our product is called UCube. It's actually for Upstream Cube, but I have rebranded it here for this particular day to the unconventional database. So yeah, just let's talk about that later. But any questions, maybe?
Okay, any, don't be, anybody got any questions?
Yeah, please, James.
How much confidence do you have in your China data? Because China has always wildly overestimated its prospectivity for coal-bed methane and has achieved very little in a very long time. What leads you to believe that, that China is going to be the big force that I get from your presentation?
First of all, we are looking at the subsurface, because I think everybody can say that yeah, China really needs the gas, but you know, it doesn't matter how much you need it if you don't have profitable shale gas resources. And there has been disappointment, not only in CBM, but also Taigas. I think it has been fairly disappointing in China. So I think that there will be on disappointments in China as well. And that is why that the, even that the authorities, they say that they will produce 80 BCM by 2020, we say that they will produce 5 BCM. So we are really on a level of magnitude when it comes to ramp up as compared to what the authorities say for China. Good.
Okay. Let me ask you a question. When you started, the first series of maps you showed had mainly white spaces in South America and sub-Saharan Africa. And actually, when you went on later, you were talking about Brazil shale deposits and so on. Why the first thing? Is that a lack of, I mean, are you actually dealing with the point Neil McMahon made, which you would have missed, which was that the places people are looking and know about are current conventional basins where there's conventional oil and gas today, and that's why you're drawn there by that data? Or do you genuinely think there are white spaces in Africa and South America that won't have unconventional plays in them?
Yeah, there were two maps I showed. I showed one map that gave the USGS total petroleum systems that is defined by the source rock. So this map with these various colors, that was just USGS source rock maps. But we have added some of the source rocks because the USGS is not complete. So there are obviously a lot of additional shale formations on top of the, because these are recognized source rock by USGS. So, on the, for instance, the Silurian shale in Poland is not a recognized source rock in USGS, so that would not appear on that particular map. So that was not intended to be absolutely complete. But the other map that I think is that is complete by definition is this sedimentary thickness map. So if you have a white space on the sedimentary thickness, then for shale gas it will be the same for conventional. You would need some sedimentary thickness.
All right, anybody else? Okay, thank you very much. Thank you for that contribution.